And when they got there, there was no room for them to be in the inn. They had to be in a stable. You know, God could have ensured that there would be a room for them. If he wanted to do it, he could have had room for them, could have had a palace. Jesus could have been born into a wealthy family and lived in a palace if he wanted to. Jesus could have turned stone into bread when he was hungry.
Amen.
But he didn't do it. Jesus could have called 10,000 angels to rescue him in the Garden of Gethsemane before he was arrested. But he didn't do it. Jesus could have come down from the cross when he was nailed up there on that cross. He could have come down from the cross and saved himself. But he did not do that. Because the question is not what Jesus could have done. The issue is, did Jesus fulfill the will of his Father? Now the shepherds out in the field were told. The one that probably was the least likely to pick was the shepherds, because they were just not well thought of. They were usually didn't go to church. They were out in the fields tending sheep. And do you know what happened when they were told about this birth? It was basically a warning that someday in the future, you're not going to need to sell lambs to the temple anymore. You're going to be out of work. You think about what they heard. The Messiah is coming. They didn't get mad. They didn't pick it. They didn't say shepherd lives matter.
Amen.
They didn't. You know what they did? They got excited. And they went running into Bethlehem, that little village. They wanted to see the Messiah. They wanted to see Jesus, that he was born. That was their response to it. I guess the question is, what's our response when we think about the birth of Jesus? Jesus is the light of the world. When the angels showed up out in the fields at night, you can well imagine it was dark. There were no street lights. They didn't have flashlights. They might have had a campfire out there, but that's about it. And when this angel shows up, it was pretty frightening to them. And we're going to learn that Jesus is the light of the world. The world itself is a dark place. Amen? It is a dark place. I don't mean just physically dark. It's dark. John 3 talks about it in verse 19. It says, and this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world. That's Jesus. And men love darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. You ever had this experience where people, when they're doing something that's wrong, do it when it's dark because they think nobody can see them and they get away with it? You know it's getting really bad when people start doing terrible deeds in the daylight. There is no shame. There's no fear of law enforcement. There's no fear of God. It's like they didn't care about doing it in the daytime. But the story says in the Gospel of John chapter 3, verse 19, it says, light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. Verse 20, for everyone that doeth evil hates the light, neither hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. God gives us light, and he gave us light in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the light. In fact, John chapter 8, verse 12, it says, then spake Jesus unto them again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. It's John 8, 12. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. We've been talking together, Pastor Kirk and I and the staff have been talking about the possibility of having a theme next year of follow me. I got the idea from Jason. It was when Jason had that camp and they went away for a few days and he came back and his theme was follow me, and I said, that is a great thing. It is a great thing to follow him. And we're going to see during this next year all the different ways that's supposed to come out in our life when we're following Jesus. 2 Corinthians 4, 6 says, for God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness hath shined in our hearts. If you're a child of God, you have the light of Jesus in you.
Amen.
You don't have that darkness in control of you anymore. You've been set free by the blood of Jesus Christ, cleansed from sin. And so God commanded light to shine out of darkness, to shine in our hearts, to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's one of the things I love about all of you. when I see Christ in you, it excites me. It gives me joy. If I see Jesus working in the life of a little child, I know everybody in here that loves kids, love kids. Amen. I love children. They're wonderful. And when you see the new life of Jesus begin to shine in their life and they start growing and following Jesus, that is the most exciting thing. It's worth it all. Acts 26:18 says, to open their eyes and turn them from darkness to light. Every person was born with a sin nature. That means we were going to be walking in darkness the rest of our life until the light of the world, Jesus Christ, revealed to us we're a sinner. When you see the sin, it's like turning the light on in the room and you see the dust and the dirt in the room and you got to clean the room up. But when you see the sin in your own life, you say, I need to get my life cleaned up. I need Jesus in my life. I need to get forgiven of my sins and cleansed. And it says, from the power of Satan unto God, and that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Jesus is the light of the world, and his light shows us the sin in our life and shows us the need for salvation through faith in him. By the way, without Jesus, there is no way. We have a tradition in our church, and our tradition is what you guys already knew to do. As we sing Silent Night while the candles are lit, and we want to remember Jesus while we're singing. I want to say to you, Merry Christmas. God bless you. I will see you tomorrow morning.
Amen. Amen. Amen.